Scripture this evening and turn to Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2 in your Bibles. And I want to say this. Yesterday we had the chance to go by to see Paul Veers. And I haven't seen him in a long time. And he said every time you wave, he waves back. And he misses his place. And so he told me to tell you all hi. And they had a great time visiting with him yesterday. And there he misses his place. So Paul Veers, good to see your buddy yesterday. And everybody's waving back to you. And there, so his health is doing a little bit better. His legs are still not cooperating the way they need to. So they have a machine that they're delivering to him. It says it'll take like 9 weeks to get to him. Really. And everybody's supposed to, I guess, vibrate his feet, try to get the blood flowing. And that's the issue he's having with one of his legs. And there, but we showed up. He wanted to come out and see. He watched all the services. I miss you singing along with everybody. I saw you sing along with because I still do. You just can't see me. And so he misses this place there. And so make sure you think about those that cannot be here anymore and pray for them. And we are blessed to be able to be here. And there. And so, by the way, I thank all the guys that get on the live stream and stuff. All that stuff really helps out these people. And so, then what a blessing that is. Let's do that. My in laws in town, Brother Miss Carson's. Here and they're up from Texas visiting this week, and so he's all about Texas, whatever. They're from that church down there that he's changing their name. I don't know what church it is, but something about Emmanuel Strong View, something like that. I guess he's getting better. We'll see. Glad you guys are here and enjoy that. Mark chapter 2, and verse number 1, we're reading 12 verses real quick. The line of prayer, you can be seated. And Mark chapter 2, starting at verse number 1. And again, he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noised that he was in the house. And straightway many were gathered together, insomuch that there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door. And he preached the word unto them, verse number 3. And they came unto him, bringing one sick of a palsy, which was born of four. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of a palsy lay. And Jesus saw their faith. He said unto the sick of a palsy, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. But there was certain, scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts. So you always have the Pharisees sitting around really trying to diagram, if you will, what someone's saying from the Bible. And you see how Christ here, he said, Son, thy sins be forgiven. And there he saw the faith of the four that brought him to that Son, thy sins be forgiven. And he had the scribes in here reasoning about it. Don't reason with God's word, just believe God's word. There. So let's keep going here and let me see. It is in verse number 7. Why does this man thus speak blasphemes? Who can forgive sins but God? Only had no idea what they were talking about. And immediately when Jesus perceived, in the spirit that they so reasoned within themselves, he said unto them, Why reason ye these things in your hearts? Whether it is easier to say to the sick of a palsy, Thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, Arise, take up thy bed, and walk. But that he may know the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins, he saith to the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, Arise, take up thy bed, and go thy way into thine house. And immediately he rose and took up the bed. And went forth before them all, insomuch that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, We never saw it on this fashion. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for today. God, I pray that you bless this evening. God, you know the thought that I'm receiving from your word. I pray that you would help me to say what you want me to say. God, help me to get out of the way and allow you to do your will in someone's heart this evening. God, I pray that you help the word of God, like you promised not to return for it. God, we thank you for this opportunity to be in your house. We thank you for this place, the Bible that you've given us. Our pastor, as he's away, pray that you bring him back safely. We
Mark chapter 2. Is this off right? Trying to get steps
certain steps to be able to get the kidney transplant. And I've been praying for her, but I love watching the service and watching the praise of the Lord and seeing your testimony. Thank you for that. Thank you for that. And there, Mark chapter 2. And be praying for Pastor Miss Bell's her way. And can't wait for him to get back. He said, you keep saying yes because he's our pastor. He's the one in charge, and he's the one that we follow, and so I wanted to be able to get back, be refreshed, ready to go, and that's my job as a pastor, is to push for him, and want him here, there, and to lead, and you're his people, and he misses you, and he misses seeing everybody, and he still told me that this afternoon, there, he misses everybody, misses the church, the fellowship, the laughter, and all of that is missed. There, so make sure you pray for him as he is away. Mark chapter 2. Our text verse this evening is verse number 1 and verse number 2. The Bible says this in Mark chapter 2, verse 1 and verse 2. Look at this here. It says, and again he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noised that he was in the house. Call it that phrase. He was in the house. And Christ was in the house. He was there. And he was about to do something. Look what it says. It was noised about. It was told. It was spread abroad that Christ was there. And something's about to happen. And we need to get there. Look what it says. And straightway. It says there that they gathered together. Many were gathered together. Straightway. They were gathered together. Insomuch that there was no room to receive them. And when they found out, when he went to Capernaum, a little while later, it was noised about that Christ was here, and he was in this house over here, and he was there speaking to people, and it came to the point to where everyone in the area said, we've got to get there and see what's going on, and we've got to get there and see what this is about. Who is this Christ we keep hearing about? We hear about the people that were healed and all the miracles going on, but who is this? Let's meet him. And I want to talk to you about this morning. He was in the house. Will you be there? He was in the house, but will you be there? He was in the house, but will you be there? Will we be where Christ is going to be? And allow ourselves to be blessed by that. Verse number 1, we see here that there was noise about that Christ was in the house, and he was coming. And that means that people were spreading the word that if Christ is in town. Christ, let me ask you this. When it comes to before a church service, do you spread the word that Christ is coming and we need to go where his word is going to be at? Is it noised about? Do you tell others about Christ? Do you tell others about what church you go to? Do you tell others that you're a Christian? Do you tell others about the Christ that has changed your life so many times, that has blessed you so many times? Do you tell others about him? Do you noise it about that Christ? We see in verse number 2. The Bible says, straightway, many were gathered together. Why? There was no room. But why were many gathered together? Listen to me. Because of the testimony of Christ. How is the world supposed to know the testimony of Christ if we don't tell them the testimony of Christ? Do you talk about the blessings of God when you're at work and out in public and around others, around family that maybe doesn't go to church? Do you talk about the blessings of God? Do you talk about what God has done in your life? Do you lift up Christ to others around you? Listen to me. That straightway, there was no room in the house. Why? Because there was no way for that. Why? Because of the testimony of God. We see here that by the way, there's many reasons. Why were there so many that showed up? Why so quickly? Why was there no room in the house? Now, Chris will say this. The house is probably pretty small. I don't want to believe that. I want to believe that there's many people. There's not room inside. And many people were gathered outside trying to hear and listen in on what God was talking about and listen in on what Christ had to say. The reason why there are many that want to be in the house and many that want to be at church, if you will, if you see where I'm going with this, many that want to be here and want to know the Word of God and want to see the Word of God is because they realize their conditions that they were lost. I mean, people don't, they realize that something is missing, and this must be it. This must be the Messiah, the one we've been waiting for. And so they knew and understood their condition that they were lost. They realized that their life was empty. Something was missing. And something was missing. And something wasn't there that needs to be there. I mean, they probably had their own businesses and the way they make money and the way they live and the way they gather things for their family. But even in all that, they knew something was missing. Their life was empty. Why
Christ. How many times I've heard story after story of people that have been saved that have come to a point in their life and said, I have everything, but something's still missing. I have everything, but I still have need of something. I don't know what it is until they realize that need was Christ on the inside. By the way, let me say this. You can have nothing of this world but have Christ and be a happy person. We say that again. You can have nothing of this world but have Christ and be a better person. Too many times we get lost on what we have in Christ. We focus so much on this world that we realize how much we really have and how blessed we really are and how much God has done for us. We would be the many that showed up to the house of God and said, God, I want to hear from you this morning. And God, I want to hear from your word. And I want to see what you're going to do. They realized their condition. They were lost. Their life was empty. They had need of something. I want to see in verse number 2, we see here, it says that he preached the word unto them. He preached the word unto them. By the way, there's nothing else better to be preaching the word of God. We don't need to preach our philosophy. We don't need to preach our ideas or things in life. We just need to go to God's word and say, God, thus saith the Lord. What do you say? What do you want us to know? And God himself, Christ himself, preach the word. Preach the word. By the way, when you preach the word, many will gather. When you preach the word, many will gather. When you tell us about Christ, people will come. Because they want to hear Christ. If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me. We see here in verse number 3. One that had faith in Christ brought the one that needed Christ the most. We had 4 men here. I don't know how they maybe knew of this person with a palsy, this man with a palsy. I don't know if they knew him, if he was a friend. It was someone maybe they walked by every day as they went to work. And maybe it was somebody that maybe was a distant relative, or maybe was someone that they had heard about, or somebody that they felt for, or maybe someone that they helped every once in a while. But when they knew that Christ was there, these 4 men said, okay, if we can just get into Christ, they had the faith, by the way. These 4 men are the ones that had the faith. They said, we can just get into Christ, that he can be helped. The one that had the faith in Christ brought the one that needed Christ the most. How much faith do you have? Do you bring those that need Christ? Do you bring those to Christ that have need of Christ? You need Christ also. But if you have the faith, are you bringing those that need the faith? Are you bringing those that need the Christ that you serve, the God that you serve? We see here in verse number 4, they did not let anything stop them from getting to Jesus. Wait, I don't know what I would have thought if I was sitting right there amongst that house when the roof also started opening up. And they weren't roofs like we're thinking. So you know when they're taking that thatch roof off, there's probably grass and leaves and mud and everything falling down inside that house. And people are going, what's going on up there? It was people that had faith that said, we're not letting anything stop us from getting into the house of God. Their faith was that great. I mean, which one of us would have said, let's get up on the roof and go through the roof? I mean, really? Who would have thought of that? They did. Because they were so determined on the inside that I've got to get in there where Jesus is. If he's in that house, then I want to be there. If Christ is there and he's teaching, people are going to hear the power of God there. That's where I want to be. He was in the house where you were there. Then we have verse 6, verse number 7, the critics and criticized. Y'all love it. They're always around, by the way. Listen, they're always around. Don't be shocked by that. They're always around. The critics are always going to criticize. You see the Pharisees here, they criticize what was happening in the house. They say, oh, they're just a bunch of weird people that go there. Amen. Thank God for the weird people. Praise the Lord. We all weird. It is weird that we bring them in too. Okay? Listen. They criticize what was happening in the house. You say, well, what they had to criticize? They were criticizing the word of God. They were criticizing Christ and the Messiah himself. Can I say this? They were so heavenly minded, there were no earthly buildings. They were so caught up in a more higher than they ought to think, and thinking of themselves better, and oh, we're super spiritual, I'm going to come and pray in front of everybody, just to be noticed. That's the type of critics they were, and the people they were. They were humble. So they criticized everyone else around them because of their love and their love for God. I would be very careful. Be very careful as Christians become it. Be very careful. I said, oh, that teenager, he's not really getting right. God's supposed to show up. Really? may be true. That may be true, but I don't know his heart. God could really be doing something to his heart. Although they're just coming on a bus, they're not really getting right with God. They're just going to pray and hope that God gets this and that. You don't know what's going on in their life. Don't be the critic that sits back and questions God working in someone's life. Don't be the person that sits back and says, oh, did they really mean it? You don't know if they really meant it in their life. You have no idea. So we can't be the critics here that we see and they criticize what was happening in the house. I want to ask this question this morning. Who was in the house when you began? Too many times as Christians, we have decided, especially now that it's getting worse and worse all the time, less and less Christians think it's an important thing to be in the house of God. Less and less Christians think it's an important, not an important thing to be in the house. It's one of the most important things in your Christian life, outside of your personal walk with God, to be in the house of God. I want you to look at Hebrews chapter 10. Verse number 25, well-known verse. Hebrews chapter 10, verse number 25. God says, not sometimes, forsaking the assembling of yourselves together. Listen to what it says. As the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more. As we see the day approaching, so much the more. The more you live, and the more you ought to want to be in the house of God. The more walls you face, the more your desire ought to be in the house of God. The more struggles that you face, and the more seas that you see, and the more seas that you, the storms that you're in the middle of, the more that you are desired to be in the house of God. Too many times as Christians, we get to the point where it's, oh, I grew up in church, I don't really need it, or I've been going to the church for so long, and Sunday morning, Sunday night, Thursday night, and I can skip one. No, listen to me, we need to be in the house of God. God said, don't miss it. God knew what he was talking about. He said, don't miss it. Just don't miss it. You can't miss it. Not forsaking the assembly of yourselves together. But by the way, let me say this. When Christ is in the house, will you be there? When Christ was around, you see the boy and the five loaves and two fishes that God used. Because he was where God was. Listen to me. Because he was where Christ was, a little boy with five loaves and two fishes was used of God greatly. See, over 5,000 people, because he was where he was supposed to be, we see here that God can do much with little. God can do much with little. What will you miss out on when you miss the house? When you're not in the house. We see that God can do much. We see the lame man at the pool of Bethesda. He was where he needed to be to get the blessing. And it had been years, and he had tried his best to get in there, and tried, but someone always stepped down before him. But he was where he needed to be to get the blessing of God. We see here that God can heal one of a long-term problem. God can heal him. Listen, God, it's been years and years I've been dealing with this. Listen to me. I feel the God that can do something in your life, and I feel the God that can help you and take things out of your life that don't need to be there. And I feel the God that can bless you and direct you in your life. We see here the lame man of long-term problem. But he was where Christ was. Will you be there? Will you be there? The woman with the issue of blood said, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I'm just going to be worse. I hear he's coming. I need to find him. Where is he at? Oh, there he is. If I can just reach through and touch the hem of his garment, we see that God can heal one that needs, but just to touch him has that much faith. And it was faith. You say, oh, it is kind of little. No, that's big. Oh, that's big. If I can just touch him, I'll be healed. We see that God said to eat and teach. God can save and use the least of these. We see here, if you read down the scripture in that portion of scripture, that the Pharisees again mocked God and were criticized him for eating and sitting with publicans and sinners and spending time with them and teaching them and witnessing, giving them the word of God. Listen to me. God can use that. God can use that. Do you remember when you first got saved? Do you remember that? I want you to stop right now and think about the day that you first got saved. What you were doing before that. And what God is doing in your life now. Think about the day you got saved. When we first got saved, God chose you and that was enough. When we first got saved, God wanted you and that was enough. I mean, that was the biggest thing around, the biggest thing happening in your life is that for somehow God wanted me. He chose me. when you first got saved and you knew that God loved you, you understand that? How could God love a person like me? And how could God care about a person like me? We have testimonies all around the world of people that just their life was a wreck and their life was in shambles. And shackles, they didn't know what to do in their life. But when Jesus stepped in, when God stepped in, something changed in their life. God chose you. God wants you. God loves you. God knows you. And He still wants you. I am so glad we serve a God that does not look on the inside and go, oh, you're not you. I can't use you. You're not perfect. I'm so glad we serve a God that will use anybody and everybody that is just willing to give and realize that God's the one in control and not me. God chose you. God knows you. And when you first got saved, you remember when you knew you needed God and church, but you didn't deserve it. You remember that? When you walked into the house of God and you went, God could have struck me dead. I don't even need to be here. What? You sit down in the pew and you looked around at everyone else around you and thought, why am I here? I shouldn't be here. This is not me. This is not what I deserve. This is not who I am. But you sit around and just listen and watch and wonder, do these people care about me? Do they think I'm weird? Yes. Do you think I deserve to be here? Am I out of place? And no matter, you realize that you needed God, even though you didn't deserve it, God wanted you. Remember when you first got saved and you wanted to be in church every time the doors were open? You wanted to sing the songs of God every time there would be a song? Remember when someone got up to sing and tears flooded your eyes thinking about how you didn't deserve to even be saved and didn't deserve to have such a good life? And oh, God's been good in my life. Listen, you remember that day? Have we lost it? Have we forgotten about it? Have we forgotten about what God did in your life years ago, and now it just becomes a mundane thing? He was in the house. Will you be there? He was in the house. Will you be there? I want to give you some things this evening that you miss when you're not in the house. When you're not in the house, what are some things you miss? Number one, you miss God's answer for what you are going through or about to go through. I want you to listen very carefully, Christian. When you miss the house of God, God is there and the man of God is working and laboring, and the table is now ready to receive the feast that He has prepared for you through God's word. And when you miss, listen to me, the answer that you need for what you're going through is probably about to be answered. You're not there to hear it. The answer that you need is right there, and God wants to give it to you. And maybe even the preacher has been praying all week that you would be there so he can try to be a help and encouragement to you. When you miss the house, when you're not in the house, you miss out on God's answer for whatever you're going through or about to go through. I don't know how many times that I heard a sermon, I wrote some notes down and thought to myself, I don't know, I can't really use this right now, and I don't know why, but I need to write this down, and I wrote some notes down. And it wasn't even a week or 2 weeks later that something may happen in my life, and my mind was right back to the sermon I just heard, and right back to that conversation I just had. And I go to those notes, and I go, okay, God, I can use this now. God, I can take this now. Listen to me. When you miss the house, when you miss out on getting where Christ is at, where God is at, when you're not there, God's answer may be given. You're not there to receive it. What you miss when you're not in the house is the comfort and encouragement that you will need. The comfort and encouragement that you need. No doubt in this age you get plenty of encouragement when you're around you. No doubt. You need that. You need that. And if you're not here, you wouldn't get it. You wouldn't get it. When you miss the house of God, you miss out. Listen, the comfort and encouragement, you'll miss it. Number three, you'll miss the chance for God to do something special through the preacher. You miss that chance. When you are not in the house, when you are not in the house where we're supposed to be, when we're not in the house, we will miss out on the chance for God to really do something. A preacher, I've been praying for years, and Pastor Bill, I've been praying for years for this to happen in my life. Well, God is right there and ready to give it to you, but you miss out. You miss out. You miss out the chance for God to do something special in your life. I think that growing up, and even now, when for some reason I'm not where I need to be in church, if it's sickness or whatever, or wanting to go to a the main thing, but that's part of it, the fellowship with the people of God. Oh, how many times that growing up that I was maybe discouraged and maybe down a little bit about something in life, and all of a sudden I walk into the house of God, and there's people there, they're just having a great day. They're up in life, and they're having a great time, and their encouragement to me got me up. See, by the way, in reverse sometimes. I'm the one having a great day, and they need the encouragement. You miss out on the fellowship with the people of God. The people of God. What are we missing out for? Do we miss out on the fellowship with the people of God for the people of the world? Is that going to encourage you? Is that going to help you and bless you? No, it's the people of God, the house of God. We miss out when we miss what we miss when we are not in the house is we miss the excitement of what God is doing in others. Listen, we miss the excitement. I love it. And when we go to camp and I get to sit back and listen to the preaching, even myself, but watch our teenagers make decisions and go to the altar and cry and want to make me cry and listen intently and make decisions. Listen, that does good for me. That excites me to see what God is doing in the young person's life. When I see a teenager, I'll start straightening up some things that they're doing and start being respectful of everything they're doing and doing the right thing. Listen to me. That excites me. That does good for me. When you miss the house, when you're not in the house of God, you can miss the excitement of what God is doing in someone's life. Number six, you miss the presence of God. For the little time that we are in church every week, you need more of the presence of God in our lives. We need more church, not less church. Listen, we need more church, not less church. We need more of God. You wonder why. Let me help you with something else. Some of your teenagers and even young people. Listen. There's two voices that you hear in this life. The voice of the world and the voice of God. How much are they hearing of each one? Are they hearing more of the world all weekend than a little bit of God on the weekend? I want you to think about that. We wonder why we have so many problems. We wonder why their attitude is the way it is. We wonder why they don't love the Lord the way you think they should. And we wonder why that they're not ready to give into God and give into what God wants. Listen to me. They're hearing too much of the world's voice and not enough of God. We need to bring this one down a whole lot and all if we can and bring this one up a lot to hear more of God. By the way, that's why we bring it to camps, and that's why we bring it to the best. That's why we have Faith Harbor Week, and we want the teenagers to get involved and young people to be here. Y'all want them to be here to hear more of the Word of God. What you miss when you are not in the house, you miss the presence of God. Number seven, you miss the chance to be a blessing to someone. You miss the chance to be a blessing, to be a blessing, to be a blessing. Is it you can get a blessing? No, I said be a blessing. It's more blessed to give than to receive. We come to the house of God and ought to be, who can I encourage tonight? And who can I shake their hand and just enjoy a conversation with them and encourage them and want them to be here and want them to enjoy themselves? And will you be a blessing? Will you be a blessing? A chance to be a blessing. You miss out on the chance to be a blessing to your pastor. Hello? You miss out on a chance to encourage your encourager. I preached about that a while back. You miss that chance when you miss the house of God. You being in your place, you being in the house of God, every time the doors are open, encourages Pastor Bill. Encourages Pastor Bill. When you miss what you miss when you're not in the house, you miss the chance to be a blessing. Number eight, you miss the chance to encourage the man of God that just said that. You miss the chance to encourage the man of God. Encourage the man of God. Your spiritual growth encourages the man of God. Now listen to me. Your spiritual growth encourages the man of God. It encourages them. You miss out on that God's answer for your problem, the comfort and encouragement that you need, the chance for God to do something special through the preaching, the fellowship of the people of God, the excitement of what God is doing, the presence of God, the chance to be a blessing, and the chance to encourage the man of God. What do you get when you're in the house? What do you get when you're in the house? Number one, you get to see lives changed. You get to see lives changed. When someone comes down this aisle and gets saved and their life is changing and they don't understand what's going on inside of them, but their life just believe in the Lord and seeing the smile on their face, and they realize that Christ died for their sins and wants them to go to heaven, and they're a sinner, but Christ took their place. You get to see lives change. When you're in that house, you get to see God working on your friends around you, and even working on you. Even working on you. But you get to see God working in families and working in couples and working in young people and working in everyone around you and get to see what God's doing. And you miss out on that when you miss the house of God. If you're not careful, we are deceived in thinking that God is dead in our life. No, God's very much alive in our life and all around us, but we've got to be willing to see it. We've got to be willing to see it. Number two. What we get when we are in the house, we get God's Word. We see God's Word still moving in people. We see God. I love watching these young guys down the front row. And I watch them how they're intently listening to every word the preacher's preaching. And they're listening, and they're writing down notes, and they're thinking about it. They're saying amen to them. Oh, hopefully they're saying amen, right? Okay. And they're like, oh, sure. Amen. All right. But listen, God's Word is still moving. If you miss out on it, you miss out on it. Number three, you miss out on it. Something to think on through the week. How many times something was preached on from this pulpit from our pastor, and it carried a thought in my mind that throughout the week I just kind of mulled over and thought about it, and maybe stopped just a little bit and prayed about just, God, what does this mean in my life, and how can I use this? How can this be a blessing to me, be a blessing to someone else? Listen to me. When you don't miss the house, when you get what you get when you're in the house, is you get something that you can think on through the week. Number four, what you get when you're in the house, you get exactly what you need when you need it. Okay, how many times? We've heard testimony. People say, I just was in my place and doing what I'm supposed to be doing in the house of God. And every time I need an answer, God gave it to me. Every time I needed something, God blessed. Every time I needed an answer for a call in my life, God gave the answer. Listen, when you're in the house, God will give you exactly what you need when you need it. You say, maybe there are two or three services. I don't have the answer. Maybe you don't need it just yet. Maybe you don't need it just yet. I was thinking about this today. You know, there was multiple times where it was sermon after sermon after sermon after sermon after sermon. Yeah, I felt like I wasn't getting but little nuggets here and there. And then all of a sudden, that one sermon brought it all together. And it was the working of God in my life over little things and little things and little things and little things. In my mind, I'm going, okay, it's something little, it's not much. But then all of a sudden, boom, something big hit. That God wanted to work on you. It was all the little things that led up to this. He'll give you exactly what you need, but what you need. Our job as a Christian is just be consistent in what we do and be what we're supposed to be. And when we do, listen to it, when we do that, if you allow God to, don't miss it. Don't miss it. It might be that one little thing that you need that's going to lead to something bigger in your life that God really wants you to hear so God can help you and give you a victory in your life. He'll give you exactly what you need when you need it. What you get when you're in the house of God, you get confirmation about your personal Christian life. I love it when I've been reading through the week or have thought through the week or thought, you know, I've never seen this in the scripture and I've read over it a couple times, never understood the scripture, and when I understand it, I go to hear the preaching and the pastor gets up and preaches, and all of a sudden he makes sense of what it is or confirms what I thought I read or I read that week and confirms in my life, like, yes, that's exactly right. I'm on track. That's where I need to be in my Christian life. Listen to me. You'll make the church confirm and give you confirmation about your Christian life. Throughout the week, the devil is just kind of hitting you with left and right, and he's coming after you constantly all week, and you come to the house of God, and God gives you confirmation in your personal Christian life that I'm on the right track, I'm doing what I need to do. Praise the Lord that God gives you confirmation in your Christian life. I want to give you some thoughts, believe it or not, in closing. I want to give you some thoughts about being in the house of He's in the house. Number one, don't just walk. Don't just walk when you feel like it. Crawl in when you'd rather stay home. Impractical. I'm going to need some practical things. Don't just walk in when you feel like coming. Crawl in when you don't feel like coming. What? That might be the service that you need. That answer that weeks you've been trying to figure out in your mind, what do I do? How do I get over this? How do I have victory in this? And how do I get encouraged about this? And how do I figure this out in my life? Listen to me. That service might be the one that you need. Too many times as Christians, if even Christianity today is just is different. And whatever you want to say, it's different. It should be different, but it is different. It is too easy to say, I'm so glad I don't. Too easy. I remember God was a kid, we didn't have a choice. Everybody's heard it a million times, but we had a drug problem. We dropped the church, so I didn't want to send my church home. And I'd be drunk, and we lived at the church, so we really didn't have a choice in it. But we were drunk to church. We were drunk. We lived 45 minutes away. And Keystone Heights, Florida. And every service, it wasn't a choice. It wasn't a choice. It became a conviction of mine, even if I've got to be in the house of God. I don't feel like it. No matter if we don't feel like it, I've got to be there. If I'm not there, I'm going to be worse the next day than I was if I showed up. It might be that service that God just comes down and does it work in your life. God encourages you and maybe puts his hand on your shoulder and says, listen, I'm your child. I'm there with you. I'll be there with you. Listen, don't just walk in when you feel like it. Crawl in when you'd rather stay home. Number two, the service you miss is the service you'll need. The service you miss is the service you'll need. Just a Thursday night. I know that word is what goes to people's minds. Just a Thursday night. And that just a Thursday night might have been the service and the sermon that you needed. It might have been the service and the sermon that you needed. He was in the house where you were there. The service you missed is the service you need, number three. Put God's house first above everything. Put God's house first above everything. Put God's house. So while I just feel like doing this today, no, put God's house first above everything. Lay down my life. Lay down my life. Give it up. Put God first in everything. Now, I want the blessings of God, but we don't want to put God first. I want God to help me go. God, if you're going to help me through this trial of my life. But we don't want to put God first. How can you expect God to give to you and bless you when you're not trying to be a blessing to someone else and you're not doing what God asked you to do? It's like my sons, if they come to me and say, Daddy, I know I've been bad all day, but can I have peace? Can you really not get peace? Can you say, can you get peace? Not if you disobey. I think I've been fine with you. He loves you. He cares about you. But how do you think he feels when he wants to bless but can't? Put God first. God first, number four. Consistency is the key to God working. Consistency. I said it a minute ago. How many times where it's been sermon after sermon, and doing something good. And it all led up, it all made sense at that point. It all led up to that one sermon that God was really trying to do something in my heart and mind. Listen, consistency. Consistency is the key to God working. Consistency. Number five, come prepared to get something from God. How many times I've heard this growing up? Yeah, it's time to go to church. No, time to get prepared to get something from God. Just about every service I sit in, when I'm sitting up here, wherever I'm sitting, growing up, doing the same thing when I was a teenager. Before the preacher gets into church, I said, God, please do something in my life. God, I need something from you tonight. Why? I don't just want to sit there. Life is too short just to sit there and waste time. Life is too short to sit there and say, okay, God, I'm just here. Don't talk. No, life's way too short for that. want God to do something in my life every chance I get. Come prepared to get something from the Word of God. Don't come prepared to ask if you can do something around the church if I can be of service, please. It's one thing to be asked, it's one thing to keep asking. I was one who said to them before, I was one that I want to be in there, so I don't want to be in the service. I don't want to be. No, come on. Want to get something from God. I'm serious. It happens. Listen to me. You don't understand. It happens. People get to that mode of, I'd rather be out there doing something, physically doing something, than sitting in a service and listening to the preaching. It happens. I'm a witness of it. It happens. I've done it. I'd rather go up out into your church instead of be up here. I've done it. It depends on how many kids are in church. But, I remember one service, I was in 10th grade. In Florida, I don't know why, I don't think this is smart, I don't know if I'm watching my grandfather, but I don't think this is smart, this is what we did. And so 10th grade, there was four of us 10th graders, 10th grade guys, and we were Sunday school teachers in 10th grade, and we ran the junior church, no adults. In 10th grade. That is not smart. But it is fun as a 10th grader. But it's not smart. I remember one time getting off the bus and getting out of teaching Sunday school and walking into junior church, and there was 115 kids in junior church. And four of us teenagers. And it was like, all right, put the gear on, here we go. Box is filling everything, here we go. No, listen, but we enjoyed it. We enjoyed it. But listen, come prepared to get something from God. Those are Sundays I wish I was not in junior church. Come prepared to get something from God. Come prepared. Look forward to the preaching. It ought to be, I need you to help over here. Okay. All right. I'll do it. Now, by the way, be willing to go, but don't look to go. Be willing to go, but don't look to go. Be prepared. Like, come prepared for God to do something. Number six. Don't be the mountaintop Christian only because we live in the valley. Don't be the mountaintop. You say, what do you mean by the mountaintop Christian only? Aren't we supposed to want the mountaintop? Yeah, we want the mountaintop. Well, listen, Faith Holiday week's not a normal week. That is the mountaintop, but it's not a normal week. Don't just be the mountaintop Christian. Whoa, everything's great. God's good. 2 weeks later. Back to the norm. We live in the valley. When it comes to the house of God, just consistency. Consistency. Week in and week out. Here at 3 o'clock. 3 o'clock. Sunday morning, Sunday night, Thursday, 3 o'clock. Third drive as a Christian, it's not just Sunday morning, it's not just Sunday night, it's all three. Three to drive. I tell the teenagers all the time, our bus team that here, tell all the time, you will not go as a Christian just come on Sunday morning. You need to be there Sunday night. You can't grow. Coming into Sunday school and going to the main service and having 2 hours of church a week is not going to help you grow. You need more. Consistency. Don't just be a mountaintop Christian only because we live in the valley. Number seven, sometimes it takes multiple services, truths, combined that lead God doing a work in your life. Sometimes this is how it is. I've been to conferences where I've heard preaching and great preaching. And it was great preaching, and then all of a sudden, man, God just broke. All of this filled. Everything led up to it. Truth after truth of God leading you in truth in your life and leading you to admit something maybe He wants you to fix or He wants you to stir up in your life. Listen to me. Sometimes it takes multiple service. That's why you can't miss them. You guys need to be here every service. You need to be here every service. You can't miss it. Because God wants to do something in your life when He's in the house. When God is here, will you be here? When God shows up, will you be here? When God is doing a work and the service prepares, the feast is ready, and the preacher gets up to preach, will you be here to hear? Thus saith the Lord. Will you be here to get the blessing? Will you miss out on it? Will you miss out on the opportunity to get a blessing to somebody, to get an answer from God? Will you miss out on that? Or will you be here to be an encouragement to someone around you and be here to get the blessing from God? What happened to our Christianity? What happened? if you think about it, when you first got saved, how much your desire was for God. Where's that desire? Where is it? We got to get that desire back. Weeks ago, a friend of mine named Steve. Listen to me. I understand our country's in a mess, but listen to me. You can't lose hope. You can't lose hope. He made the statement. He says, I don't believe America will ever see a Bible again. And it's important to me. Because if that's true or not, listen to me. We must. And the reason why there's not revival, the reason why Christians are not what we used to be, is because of us. It's not because of God, and it's not because of our church, it's because of the individuals in our churches. Our Christian lives are not what they should be. And the reason why we're revival will not come to Anchor Baptist Church is not because of Pastor Bill. It's not because it's the world we live in, the age we live in. The reason why revival will come to Anchor Baptist Church is because church is not as important as it once was. To us, to you and me. He was in the house. Will you be there? I think some of us tonight need to determine and or redetermine. Recommit. I can be in the house of God. The hell of my water, crawling in front of next to you. I don't care how tired I am. I don't care how the day's gone. I've got to be in the house of God. I've got to get something from God. I've got to see what God. By the way, God has something for you every time the doors are open. But it's a trick the devil's playing in your mind that, oh, it's just another day of church. By the way, that's why this whole thing is probably the best place to make it. Because now you realize how much you really miss church and need church. He was in the house. Noise about town. And straightway, many filled him. Outside the room, outside the house, listening, just begging. And the ones that had the lame of the palsy listening, they didn't stop at the door to go, oh, I guess as far as we go, no. They said, we've got to get him to Christ. Will you be that determined to get to the house of God and get in the house of God and hear the word of God? Or is your life alone? He was in the house. Will you be there?